I don't know about you, but one thing that frustrates me deeply in life is IKEA flat pack projects. And usually about this time of year, I'll find myself doing a couple of different things, maybe at least one thing that I've got to put together for the kids at least. And there was one time now just over a year ago where my youngest son was on the way, Ben. He just turned a year this month. And when we were getting ready for him to come, I was building a chest of drawers, and we got this very simple flat pack to come in, straightforward to put together, you would think. So I start disassembling it, and of course, as a man, I assume that my Y chromosome makes me able to put this together with no instructions. So I kind of move the instructions to the side, I take a quick glance, but it looks straightforward enough. There's walls, there's drawers, there's screws. I can work this out, I'm a big boy. So I start getting to work, putting things together, drilling, screwing, and then eventually my wife comes into the room. Now, my wife is a very intelligent woman, far more intelligent than I am, and she looks at what I'm doing. She notices that I'm not paying attention to the instructions, and with one glance, she says, I don't think that you are doing this the right way. I don't think that you are putting everything together the way that it's supposed to go. And I said, listen, you're a beautiful woman, but I know what I'm doing. So I tried to get back to doing it. I'm finishing this thing. And about 60 minutes into it, I realized that the drawers are not fitting into the chest that I've made. The reason why is I've built everything completely upside down. So the runs for the drawers are not in the right place. Things are back to front. I had completely made this thing incorrectly. I had missed the point of what I was doing. I'd missed entirely what it was supposed to look like, what it was supposed to feel like, putting everything together. And I needed to go back, and I needed to remake the whole thing, and it was incredibly frustrating. Now, we are coming to a story in the Bible today about a man who thought he had it all put together, a man who is going to find out that he is going to need to be remade, that everything that he's put together in his life, everything that he thinks about God, that he thinks about himself, that he thinks about others, is going to have to be remade. And it's a frustrating episode, it's a difficult episode, and I think it's one that when we read it, we kind of feel for him because we see a lot of ourselves in him, in this conversation that he's going to have with Jesus. Now, we are in the middle of a series on the Holy Spirit. So we're talking in particular about how the Holy Spirit moves in our lives, who he is, and what he does. And we are, as a church, trying to re-examine what God's Word says about this member of the Trinity that we can often get so confused about, that we can often misunderstand, that we can miss the point of. He is not some mystical force. He is not a spiritual showman that does magic tricks. And he is not an it. The Holy Spirit is God. And that's why this is so important as a church that we think about what the Bible actually says about him, because he is God. He is a key part of our lives if we are going to call ourselves Christians. He is from God and with God. He was there in the very beginning, on the very first page of the Bible when Genesis unpacks the story of creation. It says that the Spirit of God is hovering over the waters of the deep. That he was there at creation. And the Hebrew word that it uses for spirit is ruach. And the Spirit of God shows up all the way throughout the Old Testament. He's not someone new that Jesus introduces us to whenever we get to Jesus. He is the Spirit of God that has been there the entire time. He was there at creation. He was there when God breathed into man. He was the Spirit that God breathed into man, Ruach, and gave him life. The Spirit is the one that spoke through the prophets in the Old Testament. Whenever it says that the Spirit of God spoke through Jeremiah or Ezekiel or Isaiah, that is Ruach. That is the Spirit of God. And so we come to the New Testament, and we look to what the Holy Spirit is doing there. And Jesus tells us an awful lot about the Holy Spirit. He tells us who he is, what he has come to do. And today, we find ourselves in a conversation between Jesus and a man named Nicodemus. And Jesus is going to explain to him the importance of the Holy Spirit in his life, and in the life of all of us as believers. We're going to learn the story of a religious man. We are going to hear a very strange statement, and ultimately we're going to learn about a work of the Spirit. So if you would, read with me. We are in John chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. This is what it says. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And Jesus answered him, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus said to him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? And Jesus answered him, Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? So the first thing that we come across in this story is a religious man. Now, out of curiosity, how many of you have ever played the game Monopoly? Is there any Monopoly players? Okay, one or two. Oh, all the hands are going up. If you know anything about Monopoly, you know it is the great destroyer of friendships and families. No one plays Monopoly and comes out the other side with great things to say about their experience. Now, I like Monopoly. I like playing it because I consider myself something of a negotiator. So when you're playing Monopoly, obviously the aim of the game is you are trying to get a monopoly on a certain set of cards so you can build your hotels and you can charge everybody else a ridiculous amount of money and win the game. And usually what happens if you play this, someone else will get a card from your set that you need to be able to finish. And so I like to think in those moments, I can negotiate my way into getting what I want. That is until I met my wife and decided to play a game with her. My wife doesn't like to negotiate. She does not like to play. In fact, she will, just to spite you and make sure that you lose, will sell her cards off for a dollar to other people, just so that you can't have them. And so I became incredibly frustrated when I started playing this game because I was finding out that I couldn't negotiate. I couldn't work my way through my problem. Now, Nicodemus is a little bit of a negotiator. He is coming in this story to Jesus to have a conversation, and we're going to find out that he is a negotiator. This is what happens. It starts out, it says, There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews, and he came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Now, the first thing that we find out about Nicodemus that's important is that he was a man of the Pharisees. Nicodemus was a part of this group, this religious group called the Pharisees, and he was also a ruler of the Jews, which means he was on the council of religious leaders called the Sanhedrin. He was a part of the cultural elite. If you were on the Sanhedrin, then you were probably much older than most people. You were more experienced than most people. You were certainly far more intellectual and smarter than a lot of people. You were wealthy. You were well-respected. You had a very, very well-put-together life because you had to be. To be a Pharisee, to be a part of this council, you had to be part of the cultural elite. You had to have your life together. And now, most of the time when we read about Pharisees in the Bible, we assume that they are the bad guys. Because more often than not, in the Gospels, when we're hearing about the story of Jesus, it's the Pharisees that are portrayed as his adversaries. They're the ones that don't like Jesus. They're the ones who, in the end, set up a way to trap him, to arrest him, and send him to the cross. But the Pharisees, we shouldn't automatically default and say, well, these were bad people. Because they weren't. These were honest people who were trying to lead their community, who wanted to love God, who wanted to learn about the Bible. And Nicodemus was one of them. Nicodemus was a Pharisee. Now, again, even though that these were good people, as I've said, they didn't like Jesus. Pharisees did not like Jesus. A couple of reasons why is that Jesus was a disturber of the peace. When Jesus started preaching and teaching, he upset the status quo. He said things that they didn't like. He challenge them in ways that they didn't like. He would spend his time with sinners and tax collectors and prostitutes, people that the Pharisees said, we can't associate with them. We can't be seen with them. Those are bad people, and we want to be good. We want to be good people that please God. Yet here is Jesus encouraging people to spend time with and love sinners. So the Pharisees didn't like him. The main reason why the Pharisees didn't like Jesus is, above all else, he was insulting to them. The people that Jesus reserved his harshest criticisms for were the religious leaders, were Pharisees like Nicodemus. He said some things that were incredibly cutting and biting and critical of who they were. He called them hypocrites. He called them a brood of vipers. So there was a lot of tension between Jesus and the Pharisees, between people like Jesus and Nicodemus. So, why is Nicodemus coming to see Jesus? Why has Nicodemus decided, I'm going to go sit down with the man that most of my circle of friends and my colleagues hate? Why would I do that? Well, the next thing that we see that's interesting is that he comes by night, and probably the reason why is because a lot of his friends don't like Jesus. He's coming at night, away from public eyes, away from when people can see and hear what's happening, to have a conversation with Jesus away from everyone else. He's not coming when Jesus is teaching at the temple. He's not coming when Jesus is out doing his day-to-day things where everyone's going to see. He's coming by night. I think that Nicodemus has come for a negotiation. Because when he sits down with Jesus, what he says is, Jesus, he says, Rabbi, which is a very respectful way to talk to Jesus, teacher. He says, we know that you are from God. He doesn't say, I know that you're from God. So this is not Nicodemus coming by himself with a few questions thinking, well, I have some curiosities about Jesus and I would like to get them worked out. Nicodemus is saying, we. He's saying, I represent a group of people, probably within the Pharisees, and we think that a lot of what you're saying is interesting. We think that you are from God because you are doing amazing miracles, Jesus. There are things that you are doing that are amazing. So we know that you're from God, but there's almost a silent, implicit negotiation already starting to happen. Why? Because if this man who is part of the Pharisees, this man who is part of a group that doesn't like Jesus, is coming and sitting down at night and saying these kinds of things to Jesus, I think what he's really doing is saying, listen, we like you, but we need to work together. You can't accuse us like this in public, Jesus. You can't say the things that you're saying. We're the good guys. We're the religious leaders. We are the teachers of Israel. Nicodemus, I think, is trying to have a negotiation with Jesus. But he's the problem. He has vastly underestimated Jesus. He does not understand why Jesus has come and what Jesus really wants to say to everyone. Here is Nicodemus saying, I'm part of the good guys, Jesus, and I want to show that we can work together by sitting down and having a conversation. The problem is that there is no good guys to Jesus. There is no good and bad to Jesus. Jesus is going to show Nicodemus that he needs something far more radical than just a religious code of ethics in his life. Nicodemus needs to be more than just a religious leader, a good man who knows the Bible, probably back to front. He needs to be more than that. And I think that this is important for us today to talk about and to think about, because there are a lot of Nicodemuses in our world, certainly in churches, maybe even in this room, and I think I can be a Nicodemus from time to time. A well-intentioned religious person who wants to love God, who wants to understand the Bible, who wants to live a righteous life, but I underestimate who Jesus is and what he's come to do. I misunderstand his message, why I need him. Because Jesus is not just a teacher, as Nicodemus thinks he is. He's not just a rabbi. And that's what Jesus is going to unpack for him. He is going to issue to Nicodemus a very strange statement. Imagine with me, if you will, there is a farmer who has a crop of apple trees. every year and he grows apples. He has a whole orchard of them. And one year he decides that he doesn't need apples, he needs peaches. He needs to get peaches. And so what he tries to do first is he gets some incredible fertilizer and he goes to work and he works week after week tilling the soil, working the soil, putting the fertilizer in. Does he get peaches? No. Of course he doesn't. He gets bigger apples. Then he thinks, well, maybe what I need to do is prune the trees. Maybe I just need to work harder on actually taking care of the trees themselves. So he prunes and he prunes and he cuts back and he cuts back. But does he get peaches? No, he gets more apples. You see, if a farmer wants to get new fruit, if a farmer wants to change what is happening in his orchard, then he needs to get new trees. He needs to get a brand new crop. He needs to change the roots. He can't just work harder. He can't just prune harder. That is at the heart of what Jesus is about to say to Nicodemus. This is his response. He almost cuts him straight off as Nicodemus is talking. Jesus jumps in and says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And Nicodemus says to him, "How can a man be born again when he is old? Does he go back into his mother's womb for a second time?" This is such a strange statement. And if you've been around a church before, or you've grown up in a church, you've probably heard it more than once. Born again. And this is where it starts. This is the first time it's said in the Bible. And Jesus says it to Nicodemus. And what he's really saying is more than just born again. The word for again in Greek that Jesus used is a word anothen, which means from above. So he's not just saying, be born again, Nicodemus. He's saying, be born from above. What is he saying? What's the message here? What is behind Jesus' cryptic words to Nicodemus? I think that he is saying, Nicodemus, the fundamental problem with human beings is that we need to have our nature changed. We need to be completely remade. We need to become something new. If you want to see the kingdom of God, Nicodemus, you don't need to work harder. You don't need to learn more. You need to be born again. Nicodemus is coming to negotiate. He's coming to learn a lesson from a rabbi. He's coming to work things out. But Jesus isn't coming to negotiate. He's coming to save. Nicodemus thinks that Jesus is just a teacher. He's a savior. And you can't negotiate with a savior. You can't work things out with a savior. You've got to listen to them. You've got to depend on them. Jesus wants Nicodemus to understand his real problem. It's not that he hasn't done enough. It's not that he hasn't learned enough. It's not that he's a good enough man. It's that he needs to be remade. Who he is needs to become something brand new. This is what he's saying to Nicodemus that is probably more than just a little bit offensive. Nicodemus, you who are older than me, more learned than a lot of the people around you, who is leading the country, leading the Jews, all of your religious effort, all of your learning, all of your good record counts for nothing in the kingdom of God. Can you imagine hearing that as a man who's spent your entire life trying to learn about the Bible, trying to understand God? And here comes Jesus and says, none of it matters. None of it has any impact on whether or not you're going to see the kingdom of God, Nicodemus. It counts for nothing. What you need is to be born again. You need to be made anew. If you want to get peaches, Nicodemus, you don't need to work harder on your apple trees. You need to get a brand new orchard. You need the very roots of your life to be completely changed. That's what being born again means. It means what we value, what we chase after, what motivates us, the way we think about ourselves, the way that we think about God, the way that we think about everyone around us needs to be completely swept away and have a brand new setup put in place. Completely transformed, completely changed. It doesn't matter what our record is. It doesn't matter the level of our religious behavior, which church we're a part of, who we vote for, what we've learned, who we associate with. None of that matters unless we are born again, is what Jesus is saying. And Nicodemus is rightly shocked by this, listening to Jesus' words. He says, how? Jesus, be realistic. What are you saying to me? How can a man be born again? He's not thinking literally when he says, can a man go into his mother's womb for a second time? He's being, I think, sarcastic. He's trying to punch back at Jesus and say, what you're asking, Jesus, is ridiculous. Be reasonable. Think about what you are asking of people, Jesus. Saying that we need to be completely remade. How are we going to do that? How are we going to change who we are? See, Nicodemus is thinking about what he has to do. And that's completely missing the point. Jesus is saying it's not about what you are going to do. It's not about what you need to do. That is the misunderstanding that Nicodemus has. He's essentially saying, listen, Nicodemus, what you need is the same thing as the prostitutes and the tax collectors and all those sinners that you dislike so much. Even though you think you've lived better than them, even though you have worked harder, you need the exact same thing. You need grace, Nicodemus. You need grace just as much as they. If we look at Paul, the apostle, who wrote most of the New Testament, he's very similar to Nicodemus because he was a Pharisee too. And this is what Paul, the former Pharisee, writes in the Bible in the letter of Philippians. He says, though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also, if anyone thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews as to the law, a Pharisee as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as lost for the sake of Christ. What Paul is saying is, there was no one at being a better Pharisee and a rule keeper and a religious man than me. That's Paul, and he is absolutely correct. Paul was a brilliant man. He knew the Bible, he knew the Old Testament scriptures completely inside out. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was the rule keeper of rule keepers. He had his whole life put together. He was serious about doing everything that God told him to do. And what happens when Paul meets Jesus? When he understands who Jesus is, he says, all of that, all of my learning, all of my good behavior, all of my record, I count as loss compared to knowing Jesus. It's worthless. He's the bottom line of what this means for us this morning. If you are here this morning and you think, I have not done enough, I have not been good enough, God could not possibly want someone like me, I want you to be encouraged. Because what Jesus is telling Nicodemus is, you are no further behind than anyone else. Your record is no worse than anyone else's, no matter what you have done. You are just as loved. There is just as much grace. Jesus is as much for you as he is anybody else. But I also want to say that if you are here this morning and you think that you have got it together, you've done pretty well, you've kept the rules, you've gone to church, you have been a good religious leader, and I want you to be challenged because your record is no better than anybody else's. You need grace just as much as all of those other sinners. We all need this. We all need to be born again. That is what is most radical about what Jesus is saying, is everyone is on the same plane. Pharisees and sinners, good people and bad people, whatever you want to call it and however you want to categorize it, Jesus is saying everyone needs grace. Everyone needs to be born again. Everyone needs a work of the Spirit. This is what he says. He says to Nicodemus, as Nicodemus can't believe this, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes. and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. And Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? And Jesus answered him, are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? See, this is why I say I sympathize with Nicodemus a lot. I feel like him. I feel like when I read what I read in the Bible and the message of the gospel, I think, how am I going to do this? What do you want me to do, Jesus? Just tell me. Tell me what it means to do what you want me to do. How can I be born again? How can I do what you're asking me to do? Jesus tells us, he says, we must be born of water and spirit. Now for us, that's sometimes very religious language that we're not always sure what he means by that. But Nicodemus would have. Nicodemus would have known those words because Nicodemus knew the Old Testament back to front. And in Ezekiel, this is what the prophet said under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He says, I will sprinkle you clean with water, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness, and from your idols I will cleanse you, and I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Water and spirit, both things that are mentioned in Ezekiel, this book that he would have known back to front. And what is Ezekiel's point? What is Ezekiel saying? He's saying God needs to remake us. God needs to change us. He needs to do that, not us. And this is why in verse 10, Jesus says to Nicodemus, aren't you the teacher of Israel, Nicodemus? How do you not know this? Haven't you read the Old Testament? Haven't you memorized it? Haven't you cover to cover went through everything in there? Haven't you read Ezekiel? How do you not know that you need to be born again? The message all throughout the Old Testament is that we need the Holy Spirit. We need God's Spirit. We've always need to be transformed. Here's what God has promised to do all throughout the Old Testament. He's promised us four things. He's promised us that he would give us a new heart, that he would change what we value and what we love. We saw it there in Ezekiel. He's promised to give us a new identity, that we would be his children, that he would call us his own treasured possession. He'll give us a new purpose. He wants to give us new direction, what we are to live for, what we are to aim for. And he's given us a new destiny, where we are headed. That's what being born again looks like. The roots of our lives are changed. God and our neighbor becomes the most important thing to love, a new heart. Who we are is defined not by what we've done, but by who God says we are, a new identity. What we live for and give our time to, the reason why we work, it's not about us anymore. It's about God, a new purpose. And we have confidence that death is not the end of all things. We have a new destiny. We become God's children. But we can't do it by our effort. That's right underneath everything that Jesus is saying to Nicodemus. This is not going to happen by you doing something. He says, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Only the Holy Spirit can bring spiritual life. I can't do that, and you can't do that. You can't pray your way into the kingdom of God. You can't serve your way into the kingdom of God. You can't do anything. The Holy Spirit has to be the one that does it. I've seen my wife now have two little boys. And if you have children, you know that the experience of having a kid, having a birth, is absolutely incredible. It's unbelievable to be a part of that. And often as the husband, of course, you are the spectator and you are just seeing from afar what the mother is going through. And I watched as my wife gave birth to these two boys and realized that nothing they did made that happen. They came into the world by my wife's struggle, by her labor, by her effort. Children don't give birth to themselves. They come from the struggle of another, from their mother. So it is with the Spirit of God. So it is with the kingdom of God. If we are to be born again, if we are to be remade, it's not going to come by our struggle and effort. It's going to come by someone else's. We keep reading in John 3. We get to John 3:16, one of the most famous verses in the Bible. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." And goes on to say in 17, "For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Jesus Christ came to struggle on our behalf. He came to labor for us, to serve for us, to love for us, to suffer for us, so that we could be born again. That is why Jesus is here. That is what Jesus wants Nicodemus to understand. Being born again is the work of the Spirit through the sacrifice of the Son. It's an odd way to think about it, but if you want to, what's happening is Jesus is cutting the check so that the Spirit can come and change the pipes. Jesus is making the payment so that the Spirit can do the work. That's what being born again is. See, the only work that we really have, if we have one, is to believe in the one that God has sent, to trust in him, to know that he is doing all that is necessary for us to be remade. You see, Nicodemus, Jesus isn't your teacher, he is your savior. He is the one who gives you the Holy Spirit. So what happened to Nicodemus in the end? Where did he go? He comes up a couple of other times in John's gospel. He comes up in John 19, right after Jesus has been crucified. This is what we hear about Nicodemus. John 19, 38 and 39. "After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who had earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight." Nicodemus was there after the crucifixion of Jesus, and he was bringing spices and aloes to put on Jesus' body. Nicodemus is now doing publicly what he used to do in secret. See, for Nicodemus to do what he did after the crucifixion of Jesus was a very risky thing for a couple of reasons. Number one, he's a Pharisee. Pharisees were the ones that helped put him on the cross. And here he is now in front of his colleagues, in front of his friends, in front of his social circle, putting his stake in with Jesus. The second thing is to put spices and myrrh and aloes on a dead body in this time and in this culture was not the work of a wealthy, well-respected religious leader. Touching a dead body was the work of slaves, and unfortunately, women. So Nicodemus is humbling himself to a dramatic extent to be the one who is going to do that. He's not coming by night anymore. He's not coming to negotiate anymore. He's not coming for a teacher anymore. He's coming for a savior. His heart has been changed. Who Nicodemus is has been changed. He has been born again. He's bold. He's unafraid. He's got new priorities. By Jesus' sacrifice, God has forged the possibility for all of us in this room, no matter who we are, no matter where we come from, to be born again. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. That's why he is so vital in our lives. Let's not trust in our efforts and our religious record. Let's trust in Jesus, and let's trust in the work of the Holy Spirit. Would you pray with me this morning? Father, I thank you for the gift, once again, of your Holy Spirit, a gift that we don't deserve, a gift that far surpasses anything we could get from anywhere else. Lord, I pray that we would learn from Nicodemus' story, and like him, we would be born again. That we would not rely on our own efforts, but we would rely on yours. That we would trust not in our work, but in the work of the Holy Spirit. God, we love you and we pray these things in the name of Jesus.